the adrenaline, there's nothing like that.
Step off the sidelines, into the floodlights. Are you ready for it? Here we go. You've been waiting for it, watch the show. Ain't so nothing like it.
Are you nervous?
Well, of course not.
Anytime you want to get really good at something, you got to get obsessed with it.
Ready or not, coming in hot, show them what we got.
It wasn't that I felt like doing it. I needed to do it.
It's more of like an emotion than anything.
We were pushing the limits.
People were just, oh my God. They'd never seen anything like it.
Show them what we got.
Tell me when, darling.
Hi, I'm Tammy Hindle, Director of Donor Relations at New Hampshire PBS. I'm happy to welcome you to this virtual screening. Programs like this are made possible by viewers like you. If you are moved to engage more deeply with the content, our partners, and New Hampshire PBS, please consider making a contribution today. Visit nhpbs.org/donate and let us know you want to see more programs and events just like this one. Thank you.
Well, good evening and welcome to the New Hampshire PBS Insider Series. I'm Cliff Blake, and I'm not the star of the show tonight. I'm just going to ask some questions because tonight we're going to visit with Samantha Brown, the Emmy-winning host of Samantha Brown's Places to Love. Places to Love airs on New Hampshire PBS Create Channel and on public television stations, probably near you. It's distributed nationally by American Public Television. Samantha and her producer husband, Kevin O'Leary, are in the middle of taping the fifth season of Places to Love. And you know, from her beginnings in 1999 on the Travel Channel to her switch in 2018 to public television, her style of TV host kind of leans more to living and breathing the experiences of connecting with the people in her destinations, more than exploring all the big touristy spots, which she does too. And over the last 20 years, Samantha has traveled pretty much all over the world, visiting 250 cities in 62 countries and 40 of the United States, creating over 160 hours of programming and counting. And coming to public television, she's given us a look at the conversations with people from all over the world. And who better than Samantha Brown to share her experiences tonight as we get ready for our own travel adventures. This visit with Samantha couldn't be possible without the great people we have at New Hampshire PBS. And we're also grateful to the Grappone Auto Group, to Milne Travel, and First Seacoast Bank for their generous support of the NHPBS Insider Series. And of course, to viewers like you. Means a lot that you support us. Remember that in the chat section, you can send in a question and relay some of the comments and questions to Samantha. So let's get started. Tonight, joining us from her home in New York City, Samantha Brown is with us. Samantha, welcome. I'm so glad you're here. It's great to see you.
Oh, Cliff, thank you for having me. It's great. I feel like I'm in New Hampshire and I haven't been there in like a year and a half.
Wow, you got the New Hampshire right back. That's great.
Yes.
So, has there been a build up for you? You know, not being able to travel. Is there a build up that after 20 years of traveling and doing all this, you had to kind of sit back for a year? Are you glad you're getting back out again?
Oh my gosh, yes. I mean, just last March, understanding every episode we had lined up, and we were on our way to Europe actually to do Austria and London and Bermuda after that, and just the realization that this isn't happening and this is much more serious than we thought. And we actually were able to get a season four during the pandemic. We shot two episodes in November when the numbers were down and it was safe, and we did everything socially distanced. We were outside. If we were inside, we wore masks with people because we just wanted to travel and we knew we could do it safely from what was happening. So there was tremendous pent up just need for me to do what we absolutely love to do. And I think, it's interesting. People always ask me, what did you miss most when you couldn't travel? And it wasn't necessarily going to these great places and seeing these great sights. It was really just meeting strangers. That's something that I really love, that travel gives us more opportunities to do, is the spontaneous meeting of strangers. And just this, these small interactions you have with people you have never met. Of course, it's even better when there's a language barrier and you have to figure it out, but it's just these small little greetings and connections that make you feel like you're a human being, that make you feel like, oh, I can do this. And without that, I started to feel a real loss of travel.
Wow, I'm sure. There's a quick picture that we have of you in Shanghai that just, I think it encapsulates kind of the spirit of you. You're sort of a free spirit on the road, and I just think it's a beautiful shot. I know there's a pent up demand for travel. Probably people have been so closed up in their homes for the last year and a half. Do you think it people watching Places to Love, do you think that there's a vicarious love of travel, that they sort of travel through your eyes?
Absolutely. And you know, everything I do in Places to Love is accessible to the traveler. So it's really a call to action to travel. And that's always been really important to me. I remember when I was with the Travel Channel and we did a show in Prague, and I went to have strudel. And it wasn't in the center of town. It wasn't where all the historic cafes, where Einstein had his coffee. It was this really nondescript kind of bleak neighborhood, but we had strudel. And everyone in the forums at the time, forums is kind of the precursor to social media, were like, wanted to know, where were you? And that's when it hit me, like in, I don't know, 2004, that people were doing what I was doing. That was something that was really strange to me. I was a host of a travel show. I was entertainment, but people were doing what I did. So I really feel, and I still feel it today, that I have a tremendous responsibility to show travel as it really is, and to make sure that if I'm doing it, you can do it as well.
Mm. So as people are getting ready to get out there again and travel some more, are there any, I don't know, is there a wish list that you'd like to go travel, or is there a wish list that you could bestow on folks that are watching as to where you'd say, boy, if I were going to go, first thing I would pick some destination?
I would go as far as you can and as international as you can right now. You know, we know that the European Union is opening up to us. Every country will be able to determine its own protocols within that. But right now, there is no one in Europe. Can you imagine actually getting a front row seat to the Trevi Fountain in Rome? Can you imagine being able to actually walk the streets in Venice and not be with hordes of tourists? What a time. I would go there if I could. Actually, I am going to Europe in August, so I'm very excited. So I am taking advantage of the fact that not a lot of people will be there, and that's where I want to see it. But so my first advice would be, go as far as you can. my second would be, go where you have always wanted to go. And for me, I haven't been back to New Hampshire because of this. It was incredible just to see that I couldn't go home, right? I couldn't cross a border in a state. And just kind of thinking about that, where we were last year to where we are now. So for me, it's going home. I'll be in New Hampshire next week for January 4th. And I cannot wait. And who knew, for me, New Hampshire would be as hard to get to as, like, you know, Beijing. So, I mean, you know, like a year ago. But it's really incredible to see where we have come, where we were, and where we're going to.
I know. I wish I could go to Canada. I went to Quebec 2 years ago in August. And we just loved it. It's such a great, quaint city. I just, and you know, the thing is, there's no real language barrier in Quebec, because if you sit down for breakfast and so the waiter comes over and says, bonjour, and you go, good morning, he goes, okay, English it is.
Exactly. I love Quebec. Quebec's a great city.
What was it, effect has there been from being immunized and vaccinated? And I mean, you don't just travel in a vacuum by yourself with your husband. You travel with a crew as well. So how is it that how is travel going to be different now, domestically, even when you guys go out on the road? And we'll talk about season 5 later.
Sure. I mean, when we were shooting during the pandemic, it was pretty intense. We always had to have our masks on. Being with people, they had to have their masks on. And then just because of production rules, I could take my mask off. We could be 10 feet apart. We would have a quick conversation, and then we'd put our masks back on. So there was a lot of technicality that we had to work through. But then I would say, because I've been traveling pretty extensively now since March, getting on many planes, going to many cities here in the United States and areas in the United States, and it just feels kind of like we're back, right? You wear masks, you talk to people. I certainly what you There's a lot of mask wearing in businesses, but then when we're shooting, we kind of close the doors, lock it down, and then we can I can take my mask off, they can take their mask off. But people are vaccinated, and so you that's the question. Are you vaccinated? Yeah, I'm back. Okay, great, we're okay. So that's I would say, there's this little bit of like little dance of okay, should I take my mask off? Should I have it on? But for the most part, it just feels like it always has. And that's really, I think, speaks to the power of human connection. We are so desperate for it. Even if there's a mask on, I feel like I'm so glad that I'm just talking to someone else other than my husband who's right next to me and my children who are down in the living room. So I felt like so I just feel like it's really normal, and you just have a mask ready whenever you can, and that's kind of it. I haven't traveled internationally yet. I certainly get tests before and after I come back just to make sure, and it just all seems pretty normal, I guess.
I know. I think we're all adjusting to, I'm not going to say new normal. It's just get back to normal. And especially for you and Kevin and your family living in New York City, I mean, it was the epicenter for a while. And so everybody was locked down for so long. And now New York City has handled it so well that suddenly everything is back open again. And people are just, they must be joyous in the city to be able to have that freedom back.
Oh, it's a great feeling. It really is. And yeah, there's a lot of in 2 days my children are done full remote school. They were out the entire year doing remote first grade, and I'm sorry, they're in second grade, sorry. But yeah, we are ready to celebrate. But a lot of people did very well, and like you said, it's a slight adjustment, but it's easy. It's an easy decision to make when you realize you get to experience different places and different people when you do so.
Yeah, we have a picture of you experiencing some different people from Baltimore. You want to take a look at it? Now, Baltimore
It's
is
amazing. You're
called
with, yeah.
it's Charm City is
It's a great
Baltimore.
look.
What was this celebration of fashion?
This is the Hun Fest. So Baltimore or Balmore is famous for its Huns. And every year they celebrate this phenomenal woman, this type of woman who really came. I learned the whole history of the Hun, and it's fantastic. She was basically a single mom during World War II because the husband was fighting, and so she not only had to take care of the kids, but she also had to hold down the job. And so to take care of kids when they were working, all the wives would get together and take care of all the kids so another wife could work. And it was this Hun. It was a system of Huns. And Hun is just short for honey, Hun. And so this, obviously fashion is big, but so the Hun would finally get to go out on a Friday night after working really hard, and she wasn't gonna just go plain. She wanted to stand out. So they joke, they said leopard was her favorite color, and she'd paint her nails, and she'd put pile her hair high, because after a week of taking care of children and holding down a job, while the World War II was going on, she wanted to let off some steam. And so you celebrate one of the strongest, female types there are here in the United States with the Hun Fest. But of course, the higher the hair, the closer to God, that kind of thing. And you can put all kinds of things in your hair when you have it that big. But it was a lot of fun. It was a lot of fun being a Hun.
Wow, a beehive. One of the things that you talk about is when you get to a city, when you get to a new destination, is it's kind of like, don't read the tour book, put the map away, don't look at your phone, and you go for a walk. Where did that walking around and finding your way all start for you?
It started in Europe. So I did a travel series called Passport to Europe, and our days were spent shooting all the greatest hits, everything you would want to see in Europe. And at the end of the day, I just kind of wanted to decompress. And so I would just walk. And I, even on my day off, I would go on 6-hour walks. And I would just put, I don't think I had a phone at that time when I first started, but I would just go down streets because I thought they looked good and I didn't have any sort of itinerary. And if there was a cute cafe, I'd sit down and I would enjoy it. But I invariably would just walk away from tourism centers and go to neighborhoods where people lived. And I enjoyed going into their supermarkets. I enjoyed sitting in their parks. And I just really started to enjoy more being a part of the everyday life of a place as opposed to its tourism attractions. And these attractions are pretty amazing. So I'm not putting them down, you know, when you're seeing a cathedral, when you're seeing, you know, Mont Saint-Michel in France. You know, they're pretty miraculous and you want to see them. I just feel like with Europe, I was spending all my time in those monuments and they put me in the past. And going for a walk made me feel more a part of being in the moment. And that became much more important to me as a traveler than understanding the historic, you know, the history of a place. I wanted to know what a place was like now. So going for a walk is still to this day one of the most important things that I do, not only as a human being, but as a travel writer and a host of a show that has to sort of get it, what a place is like. I go for a walk.
Nice. Would you be walking in New Hampshire, did you say? Would you be up this way in New Hampshire on July 4th?
Is oh, absolutely.
Yes,
oh, goodness.
Yep,
you'll see me wow. Or walking around Portsmouth, New Hampshire.
So, oh, that's excellent. That's wonderful. Well, with domestic travel coming back and destinations here in New Hampshire and Portsmouth and the Seacoast, I'm kind of thinking up back to season 3 and your growing up here in the Granite State. And what you had a lot of places to love, and one of them, I guess, is some of the attractions in New Hampshire. And there's a picture that we have here of you and an engineer from the Cog Railway before you went up the mountain.
Yeah, that's Joe Eggleston. He was such a love. He is not the engineer, right? He's the engineer. So he feeds that engine, and he has always wanted to do this since he was 9 years old. He wanted to work on a train, and his dream has come true with the Cog Railway. And one thing that I learned about this New Hampshire Cog Railway, which of course goes to the top of Mount Washington, is it's the first of its kind in the world. And I thought, well, wait, no, that can't be New Hampshire. Like the Swiss, clearly the Swiss got a cog railway on top of, you know, an Alp somewhere. Come on. That's, you know, and he's like, no. And it was the first one. We beat the Swiss. So I love it. And here I am on the veranda of the famous Mount Washington Resort, which is so incredible. Just what a highlight to actually be able to go there and stay there. It's one of the first times I had been there in my life. We didn't get to go to places like the Mount Washington Resort when I was growing up in New Hampshire. That's a really, really special place. So I took advantage of it. I had like the full English
I will be going
tea.
To the top of Mount Washington.
Oh, did
Keep
we? Are we
right
and I think
there.
We actually,
There's
let's, yeah, let's have a clip.
In the Northeast. Now, there are a few ways to get to the top. I could hike it. I was told it was about 10 hours round trip. I could drive it. But the way I'm getting to the top was the first of its kind in the world. If you've never been on a cog railway, it completely feels like
of going to the top of a roller coaster. You can hear the clicks and you're bouncing, and that sort of slow build mimics our anticipation. It's building and building because everyone here on this train car, we know that where we left was warm and sunny, and it looks warm and sunny, but when we get to the top, it can be completely different. And everyone's excitement is building as the train is getting higher and more elevated, and it's just this great feeling.
I love it. And you know what? That was when those locomotives were fired by coal, and someone that was the fireman had to keep loading coal in the whole time. And I think they're on either natural gas or something else now, or diesel. So there's that smell of the coal and the smoke coming out of that stack is just part of the experience, I thought. Oh, I think your mic is muted.
Oh, sorry.
Now
I'm back. Yeah, I believe one, they have two cogs. One is coal, one is diesel, and I was on the one that's coal, which is incredible. And the way Joe, the engineer, explains it, it's like a living, breathing thing, and you're making sure that heartbeat still goes. And so it's just, it's a really special treat. I've actually have ridden a car up to Mount Washington, and I much prefer the cog railway because driving a car, you'll grow hair. I don't know. It's just like, it's very scary. Very, very scary.
The road
so
is
I like
not
the cog.
Wide.
It was a nice, easy trip.
Yeah, it's not very wide indeed. And you know, and you're looking, if you're a passenger going up, you're looking over the side down way down. Now, yep. I think we also have a picture
you deserve
of you
that bumper
once
sticker.
You got, I know, I do. I have that. This car climb Mount Washington. Now, we have a shot of you at the summit. And there you are. Look at that, a beautiful sunny day.
Yeah, I mean, come on. This is why people go there. And I mean, it's an incredible experience. And what is it? It's just people who are, you know, training to climb Mount Everest come here. I mean, it's just because the weather patterns change so drastically. So when you start at the bottom, of course, it's you know, 75, 80 degrees. And when you go to the top, it could be 32 in snow. So you really have to prepare for just about anything. really just a great time and a great spot. And I was glad. I felt like, wow, I'm from New Hampshire because I've made it to the top of Mount Washington.
Absolutely. And, you know, there's just so many places to go. I mean, the Lakes region is just fabulous. And I think we were mentioning before we got started here that this was the 98th year of the Laconia Motorcycle Week. And in 2023 will be the 100th anniversary. But you visited the Weirs. You were there at Fun Spot. And I think we have a little video of you at Fun Spot too. Aw.
Yes. Aw. We've got a great video. I spent a lot of time there. Being an 80s girl, I love video games. So when I heard about Fun Spot, which opened up in the 90s, so I was already at college, and then now I've moved away from New Hampshire. So I'm sorry, the one that I'm showing right now, I believe, opened in the 90s, but it's been there since some form of Fun Spot has been in Weirs Beach since the 30s or 40s, I believe. But I believe we have a clip. Mm-hmm. Does it start with the Fun
right
Spot?
Right by the largest lake in New Hampshire.
Oh, yes.
Is the largest arcade in the world. The Fun Spot has over 600 coin-operated games, including 300 classic video games that make up the American Classic Arcade Museum. And it's been owned by one man for over 65 years.
So Bob, I'm going to try not to be distracted talking to you, because walking into a place like this, I feel like my parents just gave me $5 and I can just play and do whatever I want. As you see, my hands are doing this now. I'm like, I'm getting a little antsy, because as soon as you start talking about video games from like 1981 to like 1986, like that, Bob, that I like peaked. So like the arcade, Bob, is my mecca. It's amazing how as soon as you walk through your doors, you turn into like a 10-year-old kid. Does that ever get old, seeing children's faces light up when they come into your business?
Are you asking me that?
I am.
You know I love kids. I walk through this building and I can't hardly walk by a kid. I carry a pocket full of tokens all the time and I give them to kids. Where did she go?
That is precious. It took you right back, didn't it?
Oh boy, well, oh boy, it didn't. And Bob was great. He was a real trooper because he actually had acting direction on that one. I'm like, I'm gonna disappear and then we're gonna have to ask you to, you know. So he played along well. And just as a little trivia, that young boy that we showed is my nephew Henry. So he made sometimes my family makes some special appearances in these shows. So that's my nephew.
Oh, Henry. That's nice. That's very nice. Now, also, we have a picture of you with the crew of the Mount Washington. We saw at the beginning of that clip the boat coming in to dock, and there's the crew and you on the Mount Washington. Look at that.
Oh, what a beautiful day. Oh, it's such a lovely trip again. This is the first time I've ever done that. Yeah. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful lake. I didn't spend much time in Winnipesaukee growing up. We always went to the ocean. We always went to like Rye and Hampton Beach. And so the mountains and the lakes, I hadn't really been to until in my 30s, believe it or not. So missed out a lot there, but I made up for it, definitely.
Well, you know what's kind of interesting is I know you were originally from Texas, but then moved to New Hampshire. And went to school in Derry and then later lived in Newcastle. So I obviously you'll be back around the Seacoast, but I did bring a little something from your alma mater. We both went to Pinkerton Academy in Derry. Now, we didn't go at the same time. In fact, I and a committee are planning our 50th reunion for this September. So I was there. Long before you were there. There's my senior picture. That's me, the cab with the doors open and the shiny hair.
Homeroom rep. All right.
I know. Look at me. Spanish club. Wow. Well, I made honor roll once. That's okay. And then the thing is, this picture, this is what my hair really looked like as a senior. But Pinkerton had rules about how long
picture?
Your hair. Yeah. Yeah. That was going to be the senior picture, but it couldn't be because they wouldn't allow that picture with the hair. So I had to go have mine recut. So actually, my head looks bigger than all the other heads in the yearbook. But I think we have some. I think we have a few pictures. Go ahead.
Well, you know, when my sister went, because I have an older sister who also went to Pinkerton. When she went to Pinkerton, seniors had smoking rights. Can you believe that? There was an area where if you were 18 years old, you could smoke cigarettes. So, I mean, it's amazing that they had that rule about hair. She didn't smoke, but that was okay then. So what times have changed?
So I know there's a lot of people from all over the country that are watching tonight, but I know that Kevin has found some interesting pictures of you from your youth. It's not just me and my hair, but there's a couple pictures of you and your hair. Can we show those, Kevin?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Aww. This is when I was probably 12 years old. Yeah. In Derry, New Hampshire, at our house on Drew Road. We lived there. And I moved there from Richmond, Virginia, from the suburbs. And I remember my first day of school waiting out for the school bus. And our neighbor told me, I better get out of the road. I'm going to get hit by a cat. And I thought, a cow? I'm going to get hit by a cow, because I had a Southern accent. And moving to this part of Derry, it felt plausible that I could be hit by a cow. but that was my first taste of the wonderful New Hampshire accent. So, yeah, you see my rainbow belt and my feathered hair. Perfect. And then this is I'm impressed with this picture. This was me now in junior high school. I went to Hood Junior High School, and I have a permed mullet. Believe it or not, and a shell necklace, which I've always been like, yeah, all right. I mean, he just, there's so much wrong with that picture. It actually is right. But I started getting into acting and theater pretty early on. And this was, are we on this one right now, Kev?
Yep.
Okay. Yep. This was actually at Theater by the Sea in Portsmouth. I did a production of Bye Bye Birdie. So I was getting into the arts and heading to the Seacoast to do some more plays. And I was in the plays in junior high school and in high school. And this picture is where I played Gooch. I was Gooch in the musical Mame. I'll never forget, the Derry News did a review of the show because they would come and they wrote in the review that I do a dance scene and it said it's Samantha Brown who plays Gooch stole the show, and that meant so much to me. I felt like, wow. So that was a really important part of my life, and I really have to give a shout out to teachers at Pinkerton. I loved Pinkerton. I had an amazing education there. And one teacher in particular was Mr. Quigley. And I was so, and I think a lot of people know who Mr. Quigley is. He was the music teacher. He was, I believe, the head of band for a while at Pinkerton. But I had him as a music teacher at Hood Junior High, and then he moved to Pinkerton. So I had 8 years of an amazing teacher, and teachers really do have a way of changing your life and setting you on a course for just success. And he was instrumental in that success. So he was the director, and so I'll never forget his influence on my life. And this is me as a cheerleader. I was varsity captain. I was a captain of a cheerleading team, the cheerleading team. And I still have that P with my name in it, Sam. I don't know why I didn't want Samantha. I have no idea. Maybe I thought it was cooler being Sam. But I still have that P in megaphone. And I still have my varsity cheerleading jacket. So a lot of great memories at Pinkerton. And this is me at my graduation. And with my mom and my sister, Katie. And so just these are just all proof that, yeah, I think Pinkerton looks a lot different now, right? It's this really phenomenal campus. I actually have not been back since I graduated. So I know that there's like a theater and there's a whole stadium and it's just a state-of-the-art school. But I went when it was only 3,000 kids went, which was incredible. So it's a really big high school. I loved my education there.
I think that my class had about 146 or something like that in it, and we could all fit on the front steps, for our picture. And then it was funny too, because I graduated there in 1970, and it was just the year before that man had landed on the moon. And of course there was Alan Shepard, the first US man in space, went to Pinkerton too. He's an alumnus too.
Yeah.
And so his picture's hanging up there, but in fact, the gymnasium was the Shepherd Gym, but now they have this
That's
gigantic
right.
gym. So you're right. It's,
yep.
it's turned into a huge,
Shepherd
huge
Auditorium.
Place. Shepherd Auditorium. Yeah. That's where the plays are. So that's kind of, the time in your life when the theater bug bit you. Do you think that having done theater, I mean, you kind of are doing theater on TV, sort of.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because of my great experience at Pinkerton and Hood, especially Pinkerton, doing plays with Mr. Quigley as a great mentor and director, I went to Syracuse University for musical theater. And then from there, moved to New York City to be an actress. And, you know, if you're in musical theater, you can sing, act, and dance, and you're considered a triple threat. And when I moved to New York City is when I realized I wasn't threatening at all. Like, people are really talented here. So I felt really, I'm like, oh my gosh, what did I do? And I waited on tables for almost a decade, just going to auditions and waking up at like 4 a.m. to wait in line to put my name on the Actors Equity list to be able to audition for Broadway and off-Broadway. And then from there got this job, the opportunity to audition as a host. And at first I was like, what's a host? I'm not a host. I've come to New York City to become a Shakespearean actress. But a lot of what I've learned in school, whether it was Pinkerton and then Syracuse University, in acting, you learn that your job and your intention is always in the other person. And that's what's important. And you never judge your character. So not judging people, always being interested in the other, is still a very much a part of my toolkit now as a host, as it were. But also just the ability to improv. Improvisation is a huge talent that they teach in acting school and musical theater, being able to just improvise. And there is no script in what I do. There's no script. I certainly have notes. I write down questions I want to ask. But everything that I do is pretty much off the cuff. And then we kind of write it later with voiceover and that sort of thing. So that all plays into going to school for acting, really loving theater, and then being able to travel the world and use those skills and talents to kind of explore it a little more.
Nice. We have a couple of questions that have come in from folks that are watching. Valerie would like to know, back to travel, how do you travel so often with two small children?
I don't. They stay home. When I'm working, we do bring them on trips a lot. They've been able to go to Hong Kong and South Korea, and they've gone to like 10 countries in Europe. So they do get to travel with me some. It is hard. And my husband and I do a lot. I travel, and full disclosure, we have an amazing nanny. So we have full-time help because someone has to look after the kids when you're in Hong Kong, right? Certainly juggling. I was told when I wanted to have children that my job would end, right? I no longer could have my career. And I thought, well, no, that's not going to happen. And so I'm really proud of the fact that I'm one of the sort of the examples of a career woman who should have had her career should have ended because she had children and decided she was going to pave her own way instead. And the children, just because they know I travel a lot since the day they were born, they get it. And now it's nothing. You know, I go away for 10 days at a time sometimes, and they miss me. I miss them. But it's just understood that this is my career, and that mom has worked hard to have her career, and we love it. And when we do get to bring them along, you can always tell the shows that my kids were there because you can see how tired I am. Like, you can see the bags under my eyes. So it's because you are like, I mean, your kids just want you, and now you've put in a 12-hour day, and now you want to be with your kids and they want to be with you. So there's a lot of long days, but it's definitely, oh my gosh, it's so, so worth it. I will say that before I had kids, I gave a lot of people advice on what to do to travel with children. And I just want to apologize to all those people. I could not have been more wrong about the challenges and how stressful and how different it is traveling professionally and then traveling with kids. It is hard, but absolutely worth it.
Oh, awesome. Another great question. This one's from Susan, and it doesn't say where she's from, but thank you for watching and thanks for the question, Susan. Do you find that your favorite places have anything in common?
Yes. Good question. I find there's a few things. The two countries that I loved most going to, one, Nicaragua, and two, Cambodia. I love both those countries. There's something about them that I just connected with instantly. And I thought about that. Why those two? And both of them at the time, I was there in the early 2000s for both of them. Places that come out of strife, that come out of a really difficult time. So Cambodia, the Khmer Rouge, and then Nicaragua, you know, the Sandinistas and that whole debacle from, the 80s. There's this moment that there's a sea change for them, and it's when travelers start to come and they see that in you, and you want to know about them and they want to know more about you. And so there's this beautiful reciprocity of just interest. So, you know, you're going to go to Rome. There's not one Roman who's going to care you're there. They just don't. And nor do they have to. People have been traveling to Rome forever. Europe, whatever. When an American goes to different countries, it's it's really powerful. And I've always loved that. I've always loved also because of that, I've always loved underdog cities. So I call them, there's the A sides and the B sides. So the A side cities are New York City. And then of course, San Francisco and Paris. But for me, I've always loved the smaller cities. That's why we did Baltimore, Asheville, North Carolina, Huntsville, Alabama. These places that maybe you would think, well, why would you travel there? But I guarantee you, you watch one of my shows and Places to Love and you will want to go, because the people are just incredible and the experiences you have in those places become much more personal just because they're not the A-list city. And so, yeah, there is a real common theme with the places that we choose, certainly in Places to Love.
Nice. This is an interesting question from a woman, Judy T. And as people start traveling again, she wanted to know, do you ever feel unsafe when you travel?
Gosh, very, very rarely. And I walk around alone a lot. I hope my mom is not watching. She will be very upset with that, with what I just said. But I like to walk and I like to just feel how neighborhoods change. And I also am always aware of how the energy, how I am being perceived. And so a lot of what I say to people is, especially women traveling alone, is you never want to walk around with earphones in, right? You want to be very aware of your surroundings and just always trust the hairs on the back of your neck, because they know so much more about your safety than any tour guide, any front desk clerk who says, oh yeah, that's fine, that's safe. Your own intuition is going to inform you a lot. You won't know it, but it's there, and trust it. And so in the instances, and there have only been two in my 22 years of travel where I thought, oh boy, this is not, I should not be here. I knew beforehand that something was probably not up. Now, nothing happened. I was perfectly safe. It went away and I was okay, but I felt it and I should have trusted it. And other than that, I think being a solo female traveler is phenomenal, and I highly recommend it. And any form of solo travel, male, female, whatever, just traveling alone where you get to do whatever you want and you don't realize it, but people see that you're alone and you open up to people and people open up to you in a way that they wouldn't if you had a travel partner. So I love being alone. Again, sorry, my husband's right here. but I just think it's such a phenomenal, rich way to travel. Rich, I mean, in terms of experience and just what you get out of it. So definitely, definitely do it.
Nice. Now, I'm hoping that Ben can pop up the dancing snowman, because I have a curious question that goes sort of on the opposite of the dancing snowman. Rick would like to know, what is the hottest place you've ever visited? We see there's a cold one there.
Yeah, that's actually Quebec City, Cliff. I was there for Winter Carnival. So I know Canada is slowly opening up, very, very, very slowly. It won't be open for the summer for Americans, but I'm telling you, make your plans to go to Winter Carnival, because we had a blast. And this was in February in 2019. It was so cold there. It was like, and I went ice canoeing, which is actually a sport in Canada, of course. But the hottest I've ever been was probably Singapore, you know, Southeast Asia, where Singapore gets to be like 103 degrees by 10 a.m. And so it's, you know, there's a lot of towel padding and that sort of thing. New Orleans also is a pretty hot place in August. So these are made difficult because of the heat. I would rather be cold than hot when I'm on camera, that's for sure.
Hmm. You talk a lot about, as you said, the Huntsvilles and the Ashevilles and the smaller cities that aren't the glamour capitals, but there's still such value there meeting those people. And is there maybe you could explain a little bit about this. There's the exclamation points and then there's the comma, and you talk about the comma. What do you mean by the comma in your experiences?
Yeah, so I feel like, and this is definitely based on me always for a while in my career having to show the exclamation points. And they're sort of the must-sees and top fives and the things that are full of superlatives and you have to do this. And I feel like it just becomes a little bit more of like, I don't know, just a little too tourism driven, right? And what I've really appreciated is the more mundane parts of life when I go to a different location and finding what's just more relaxed and what's more everyday, being in the moment. And so I find in the commas is also where I relax and I kind of take in what's happening a little more, and I'm a more part of the place I'm at, whether I'm, you know, as opposed to just going from one exclamation point to the other. So I feel like the travel industry, and I say that with big quotes, the travel industry, this billion-dollar industry, wants you to know about the exclamation points. And when you follow people maybe on Instagram or Facebook, it's all about, look at me, check me out, here I am on the, you know, back of this cliff, and isn't this amazing? And that's not what travel is about. Travel is really about those more intimate moments where you connect with people, where you connect with something you never thought you would. And it just allows you, again, to have a much more personal, more intimate, more valuable travel experience. And so I think, you know, there's this always this push for us to have these, you know, go to see the top fives. And what I like to tell people is that, no, you don't. You just take time. And that's why I like to go for a walk, because those commas kind of come up. I like to do things like, I create a ritual. So I do one thing, the same thing every single day. And I know people think that's crazy because we're Americans. We got to travel every day, and new, you know, every minute has to be something new and never go down the same road twice. And I don't believe in that. And I like to create a ritual and have a cup of coffee at the exact same cafe every day. And that just allows me to feel the ebb and flow of a place better, feel like a local a little more. And in those commas is when you can turn to someone who's next to you and say, hey, I was thinking about going here. What do you think? Because they're probably a local. So it just allows me to open up more. So I always say, you know, I'm more for the commas, less for the exclamation points.
I think that's kind of, I think it's very important, because to kind of harken back to our earlier discussion about leaving the Travel Channel and then going to public television, you have a different show now than you did then. I mean, maybe there were a lot of exclamation points on the Travel Channel shows, which were very good. But now you can have some in-depth, heartfelt conversations with people, funny conversations and serious conversations. And just I know that you get a lot of pleasure from the experiences that you, like you said, the mundane. And maybe that's a word that is maligned, because, you know, the mundane people are the people that live in the spot. And tell us about some of those thoughts about the experiences and how this series for public television is different from before.
Oh my gosh, it's vastly different. I mean, first of all, the public television audience is by far the best audience in the United States. And I know I've been on a lot of different, you know, with Travel Channel, I was a part of Discovery, and then we were part of Scripps, and I know audiences. And the public television audience is still so phenomenally curious and almost insatiably so. They're looking for more than just the obvious. They've done the obvious. They probably have traveled to the obvious, and now they want to know more. Now they do want to get a richer understanding of a place. And so there is nothing more satisfying than knowing when we pull into a city, we know we can really talk about, I mean, some difficult subjects, because it is a part of the travel experience. It is meeting people. And I remember being with the Travel Channel, the difference of the shows were, it was all about me, and it was all about how I was feeling, and I really didn't want it to be about me anymore. I'm a vehicle. But I want to reach and talk to the person right now who's, you know, on the other side of the screen, and I want to connect them to the person that I get to meet. And I thought it was just far more interesting to understand the effort that it takes to create these experiences that we as travelers just get to show up and have. And we know with the public television audience, there's a real need to get away from being a consumer all the time. We are just inundated with, you know, ads and, you know, brands, and we don't want that. And so how do I take a person watching away from being a consumer and more a part of a community? And so that's the whole basis of the show. This is a show that could not exist on the Travel Channel. It couldn't even exist on the Discovery Channel anymore. It would be seen as slow. It would be seen as no exclamation points. They want the exclamation points. They don't want any commas. And it just was something that I just wasn't, it just didn't fulfill me anymore. And I'll never forget that our very first episode on public television, Four Places to Love, season one, episode one, was the city of Houston. And I thought, oh, I'm going to get it because everyone knows me for Disney World and you did this and you went here and you went to Paris and now you're doing Houston, Texas. But Houston, Texas is a phenomenal city, right? It's the most diverse city in the United States. It's the number one refugee city. All refugees from other countries go through Houston, and that has affected that city in phenomenally diverse, wonderful ways. And so I wanted to show that. And when that episode aired, the public television audience got it. And it just felt so good that I had found really my home. And so I'm a big advocate for public television. I think people should support it more, obviously, because listen, again, I come from the television, broadcast television world. The programming that's on public television doesn't exist anywhere else. It doesn't. And the idea that I can just turn on public television and no matter what is on is going to be worth my time, is going to give me knowledge that I didn't have, give me a point of view I didn't have, that perspective that I so desperately need in these times, these challenging times, where you can't say that about any other channel on television or certainly online, where just the quality of programming there isn't this defining mission like public television. So it's been a phenomenal home for me. I only want to challenge myself to get better for the audience. And there's no better audience than public television. So thank you, everyone who's watching. I really appreciate it. I think we all appreciate you because, of course, it's the viewer. It's viewer supported. So support public media.
Indeed. You know, in making travel count, you mentioned that you like to visit a city as a local. Do you have here's a good question. What's your favorite food?
Oh, boy.
It's a quick question. So there's a follow-up.
Yeah. I love Asian, all Asian, like literally all Asian food, Southeast Asian, Malaysian, Chinese, Japanese. I love Asian food. And so that's my answer.
And there's places that you like to eat when you're either doing a show or you're traveling, right? What are the places that you love to eat at?
I love strip mall restaurants. I will literally case them out. You know, I'll pull into a big parking lot and I'll just look and see, you know, and there's usually a dollar store and like a Radio Shack and some maybe Tractor Supply shop. And then there, boom, there it is. And it's like this, either this Mediterranean or maybe it's Cambodian. I found a great Cambodian strip restaurant in Los Angeles. And why I love strip mall restaurants is that it's always family owned. It's usually first or second generation American. So you're getting the food from the country that these people were from that couldn't find it themselves and decided finally when they could move out of the city, make some money and move to the suburbs, they were going to open up a restaurant. So you're supporting the American dream. You're having food you've never had before that is so authentic to the country it's from, and it is totally affordable. So I love striking up conversations with the people who own them. I love the fact that you go in there and like no focus group has obviously decided any of the decor. It's just like a little mash of everything. And it just comes so authentically to, I just think it's just an honest way to, support people, especially in the restaurant world. But yeah, we've done quite a few strip mall restaurants in Places to Love. And that's Totally beneficial to me and my love.
And me, it's diners. I just love to go in the diner. I love to sit there at that chrome counter with the shiny seat that revolves back and forth. It's just wonderful. Now, thanks for that. Wonderful insights. Can we look ahead a little bit to season 5 that you have in production now, you and Kevin? What can we look forward to with the next season?
Oh, sure. So we are doing fabulous cities. We were in Asheville, North Carolina, as well as the Finger Lakes of New York, up in the Genesee River Valley area, Louisville, Kentucky, a lot of bourbon. I made it through. And then we just got back from the Jersey Shore. Yeah. So really excited about that. And then we're doing a Colorado episode. We're going back to Houston, Texas as well, because we just love that city. And we want to revisit as well as show a lot of the other great things that are there. And then hopefully we'll be heading internationally in September, October, when things and protocols lighten up a little bit more for a shooting crew. But it's a phenomenal season. And I can't believe we've been chugging along this entire time, really.
we're nearing the end of a wonderful hour, but I guess I do have another question, and I saw it in the clip when you were looking at the top of Mount Washington with your teacup. What's with taking the teacup everywhere you go?
Oh, yes, I do. I do. I travel with a teacup, and I do because I'm gone for 12 days, and it just gets depressing opening up another, wrapping the plastic off of another paper cup, and I just love that. That moment I have in my hotel room with my teacup from home. And I travel with a teacup.
Well, listen, we're very grateful for your time, but I also wanted to do a pitch because I know that you have a luggage line on Home Shopping Network. And I think that since 2011, you've had that. Can we show that luggage? There's a piece of luggage that I'd like to show everybody. Oh, look at that. And it has a lovely piece of luggage. I just figured, listen, you're very kind, and I think it's wonderful that this side business has turned into such a wonderful business for you. So congratulations. And if anybody has any questions about that website, just get in touch with us.
Well, I appreciate that, Cliff. I always like to say I've always had baggage and now I have luggage. So.
Listen, are there any other last travel rituals that you can tell us about?
Oh gosh, travel rituals. I think, you know, for me, travel is just about just being in the moment. And I think especially now we've come out of a really difficult time. And for me, we've seen people be really fiercely protective of their local businesses and their local shops and their artists and their musicians. And I just hope that the trend in travel will be to take that with us wherever we go and understand that no matter how far you go, it's someone else's local. And so for me, a ritual has always been to be with the locals. And because I'm with the locals, whether if I'm staying in a hotel in more of a residential area or I'm going to their supermarkets to pick up things for a picnic lunch, I feel that that also just brings the cost of travel down, which I know can be prohibitively expensive. But it also just allows you to really connect with people today. And enough can't be said for how much we need as a world, a population of human beings to connect with other people. So a ritual is just to connect, I would say, connect with people, connect with strangers. They'll really surprise you. And I guess I'll just leave it on that.
I think they will. I just am so grateful to get to talk to you. And I know that the folks watching have been engaged and they just are some your biggest fans, and I just I thank you for your insights, and I've learned a lot about you, and I hope everybody else did too, because that's kind of the point of doing the Insider, is to kind of get beneath the surface of somebody who's on TV all the time and your expertise and your experiences. And it's been such a wonderful experience for me to be with you tonight. Thank you so much. It's been great. You're an inspiration.
Thank you.
And you know what it is? It's almost like I was saying something. I was going to read this off the end. It's like travel, I think, is more than moving from one quick photo op to another. You know, like National Lampoon's European Vacation. It's like they hop from one exclamation point to the next. And it isn't really the selfies we take. It's the people we meet and the relationships and the experiences we have. And all of us at New Hampshire PBS are very grateful to you. We love having your show. We love to watch it. And we are looking forward to many more seasons of Samantha Brown's Places to Love. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. And listen, she is lovely. But it is time for us to just kind of close out. There's a lot of New Hampshire PBS people to thank. They make the Insider Series happen. Thanks to our President and CEO, Peter Frid, and VP and Chief Content Officer, Don DeAngelis. Director of Communications and Creative Services, Carla Russell does it all. Thank you, Ben Sparling, for directing our production tonight. Montana West, Kathleen Young, Skylar Scribner for your technical support. And Bryn Burns and Susan McAtavy for corporate support. Oh, and thank you to our sponsors for Seacoast Bank, Milne Travel, and Grappone Auto Group. Thank you for your financial support to make this come true. And of course, productions both on air and online depend on the support of folks like you. I hope you'll consider being a sustaining member of either New Hampshire PBS or your local PBS station. I think Samantha really said it best. We're happy you joined us for this Insider Series, and we'd like to know what you think. We'll be sending out a little survey from us because your responses will help us to make the Insider Series even better. So thanks for a great evening. I hope you enjoy your summer of travel. Thank you very much. Good night, everybody.
Look sharp this summer with the limited edition New Hampshire PBS commemorative Seabags Tote. This stylish tote is versatile enough to go wherever the day takes you. These bags are made of recycled sails and are transformed into nautically inspired totes and are all locally made. And this exclusive Lake Winnipesaukee design was created for and is available only through New Hampshire PBS, and quantities are limited. So your tote will be a collector's item the minute you pick it up. Get your collectible Seabags tote now by supporting New Hampshire PBS at nhpbs.org/donate.